In this episode, I am once again joined by Duncan Barford, occult practitioner, counsellor, and author of Occult Experiments in the Home. Duncan takes a deep dive into the different categories of spirits and entities, ranging from ghosts, to demons, to angels, to elementals, and land spirits. Duncan reveals his own encounters with these entities, recalls paradigm-shifting fire casino retreats with Daniel Ingram, and shares his own ideas about the importance and inevitability of working with the dead while on the spiritual path. Duncan also explains the Goetia, a controversial system of summoning demons for personal gain, recalls his own and others' experiences of the system, and reflects on what drives practitioners to seek tangible contact with the realms beyond. So without further ado, Duncan Barford.
Duncan Barford, welcome back to the podcast.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, Steve.
I'm so delighted to be talking with you again. Our first episode was together was so fun and proved to be extremely popular, actually. And we left it, though, on something of a cliffhanger. Mm. We had talked in that episode a lot about your own life, your own path in magic, in meditation, Arhatship and beyond, and it was great, but the cliffhanger was entities. In fact, we had that was the basic reason we had got together in the first place, was to talk about entities. We sort of left it as a cliffhanger. Last time you said that there is a spectrum of entities that one might encounter, and that one of the ways in which you can determine the sort of entity you're in communication with is, as you put it, to quote you, it's all in the nature of the relationship.
Yeah.
And that's very interesting indeed. So I was hoping we could go into that. Now, where ought we begin? I know you've got a list there, you told me, of different sorts of entities, a sort of spectrum, if you want. We could begin with that, or we could begin with your own history of entity contact, which to you seems the most reasonable, given what you've got written down there.
Well, I think the idea of a spectrum of entities is just something that I found helpful. I mean, what I'm going to be talking about is based very much just on my experience. And I wondered if, with respect to that, a good place to start might be with some ontology. What do we mean when we're talking about spiritual entities, you know, and what is the experience of that like? So where I've come to with my thinking about this so far is that it's important to remember that none of these entities exist. They do not exist. And by that, I mean that they don't have any form. They don't have any physical form. I mean, my belief is that there will never be any proof for the existence of any of these entities because they don't exist in the first place. You know, if we go out with EMF meters, you know, trying to pick up some sort of physical trace of them, we won't ever find that. There won't ever be that, you know, because this is not their nature. There's not something here that's waiting to be known by science, you know, because it can't be known, because these things have no form, and they're not perceptible by the senses, you know, by the physical senses, sight, smell, touch, etc. So there are spirit for me, I would define as that which doesn't exist. You know, it doesn't have any qualities. It's not there in a physical sense. It's a kind of nothingness. But the strange thing is that even though there's nothing sensory there for us to get hold of in the experience of these beings, nevertheless, there are differences between them. You know, and then we're faced with this weird question: how can something that's nothing be different from another kind of nothing? But you know, again, this is something that's sort of hiding there in plain view, you know, like a lot of things about spiritual reality are. This is something actually quite commonplace. I mean, one example is relationships. You know, have you ever seen a relationship? Can you touch a relationship, smell it? You know, but of course, it's something that shapes our whole existence. And even though relationships have no physical form or qualities, you know, nevertheless, they're wildly different between different people. And I was thinking about this as well recently with regard to numbers. You know, numbers are similar. I mean, I'm no mathematician, you know, I don't have any mathematical talent at all, but you know, you never see a number. Numbers don't physically exist. You know, you don't see the number three or anything like that. But numbers are real. You know, they shape our reality. And even though no number exists physically any more than any other number, nevertheless, they all have different qualities. You know, numbers have different properties, odd numbers and even numbers and perfect numbers and composite numbers and prime numbers. You know, they're all numbers. They don't have any basis in the physical world, and yet this kind of nothing can be different from other kinds of nothing. So, I mean, that's where I've got to, really, with understanding the nature of these things. They don't exist. They're all a kind of nothingness, which is the nature of spirit. And yet, nothingness can appear in different kinds of varieties. I don't know if that makes any sense.
To carry your analogy of the relationship further on, you can't touch, taste, see a relationship, but you can feel its impacts, its consequences.
Absolutely.
In feelings of love, jealousy, etc., etc., light and dark feelings that can be evoked like magnetic filings being pulled out by a magnet.
Yeah, and what's more real than those sorts of feelings? You know, the impact on us is palpable, is real, is consequential.
So if relationship is detected, one of the ways by the response it can evoke in us, say a romantic relationship or friendship or so, how are entities detected?
Yeah. And again, you know, like we were saying, it has to be in the quality of the relationship, you know, what's going on in that dynamic between us and this entity. So, I mean, you know, people are often quite interested in, you know, what's described as demonic entities. And my experience has been that what we call demonic is characterized by a type of relationship where, you know, this entity will want something from us, will demand something, will want to engage in some sort of transaction with us. And usually what's the case is that this interaction is deleterious to us, you know, to our disadvantage. I mean, that's the thing to look out for, I think, when we're talking about something that's demonic. You know, demonic entities want to take something away from us, want us to give them something. And they may promise something in return. But overall, the impact of that relationship will be, you know, some sort of loss or some sort of inhibition.
What sort of things are wanted and why?
Yeah. Well, I mean, the classic example, of course, is the Goetia, Goetic magic, which is a particular magical system that still gets a lot of attention from magicians, you know, in Western magic. And, you know, just to give a brief outline of it, there's a grimoire, a list of, I think it's 72 different demons that provide different qualities, different services. You know, you can get demons to teach you mathematics, demons to give you treasure. You know, and the idea is that the magician goes through this list, selects a demon that they want, and then evokes it. And this magical system comes with warnings, you know, that there has to be protection against these spirits because they will exact things from the magician if they're not kept properly under control. One of the things that I've seen a lot is people who use this system arguing that, that these demons aren't really demons, that they're actually gods that Christianity has suppressed, you know, has turned into demons. And you know, there is some historical basis for that. You know, it's possible with some of the entities in the Goetia to trace them to pre-Christian deities. But when we're doing this sort of magic, that's not the basis on which we're engaging with these entities, you know, regardless of the history. We're engaging with them on the basis of we're trying to exact something from them. We're trying to get something, you know, and give in return as little as possible. You know, so that's not the relationship of a person to a god. You know, so, you know, I understand there may be a historical basis for this, but on the ground, when we're doing this magic, that's not the relationship that we're entering into. You know, we're trying to extract something from this being. So, I mean, of course, we don't learn about things like this, you know, really until we experience them. And this was a magical system that at one point I was really fascinated by and did have some experiences with. But they were never very positive. And the thing about the Goetia is it feels creepy when you do it. You know, when you do the evocation, when you've got the circle set up and the triangle, you know, and you go through the whole rigmarole, it feels sinister. It feels like something dark is being called into being. So, yeah, not something I recommend people to engage with. But on the other hand, I understand that, you know, people will do that because that's the way really to understand what this form of magic is about. I mean, there's a story, you know, I've often told it, you know, in lots of different places, but, you know, using a goetic demon once to get some money. You know, I asked a demon for some cash, which was an absolutely stupid thing to do magic for in the first place. So I did this goetic working, and then a couple of days I'm in a shop and I'm standing behind someone in a queue. And, you know, the short version of this story is a load of money falls out of the guy's back pocket in front of me, falls onto the floor like a roll of notes. And I bend down and I pick this money up. And it's as if everybody in the shop has gone into a trance. Nobody sees me do this. And I could easily have pocketed, you know, this roll of cash. But it felt wrong, you know, stealing. So I gave the money back to the guy. This is the nature of that sort of magic. I'd done a magic for some money, but what it meant was I was going to have to steal it in order to get it. It was presented to me, but it would have been stealing to take it. You know, it's dirty money. The description of the entity that I was working with was he steals money from the houses of kings, you know. So there it all was on paper in front of me. You know, in order to get this money, I would have to steal it from somebody. You know, maybe somebody who had a lot, but it was still stealing. And there's a very addictive quality to these sorts of entities. I've seen people who, you know, they'll use goetic magic and they get a result, or they get a kind of partial result that's sort of almost there, you know, but there's a sense that if only they did a little bit more work with this system, then they'd get to where they want to be. You know, it has a kind of quality about it that kind of pulls you in. And once people are in this system, you know, it's very difficult to let go. I mean, I remember at a group meeting once, we did a group goetic working with a particular demon. And I remember the morning after, we were sitting around a campfire, and the guy who'd led this working, very experienced magician, the seal of the demon was still left over from the ritual the night before. I remember this magician, this guy saying, "Oh, this demon's great, you know, we'll keep his seal, he can stay around." And then I saw him sort of catch himself and think, and he said, you know, he said, "Did you hear what I just said?" And then he screwed the seal up and burnt it, you know. So even I mean, what I took from that was even a experienced magician can get drawn into this. You know, these Goetia, I've heard described, I think it's Lon Milo Duquette who describes it as magic of last resort. It's a magical system that you would turn to if you were desperate, if there was nothing else. You know, these are entities that maybe you shouldn't build a relationship with, because the nature of that relationship is by definition, it's going to take something away from you. And one thing I've been struck by again and again and again, this is so, so strange, but so characteristic as well, is, you know, sometimes I've had communications from people who, you know, have been troubled by a sense that they're under the influence of a demonic entity. But when you start to probe this, when you start to think about with them what they might want to do about that, so strange, you know, that they'll defend it, they'll want to hang on to it. And again, it seems to be part of the relationship that is characteristic of the demonic. You know, it's a kind of parasitic, symbiotic sort of relationship. Now, these entities, they get a hold on us, they promise us something, and it's made to seem that we're the ones who will benefit from that. But for them, it seems to be attention, seems to be something very important. You know, they seem to crave attention, and they seem to thrive on that.
The Goetia, as you said, is a system that still gets a lot of attention. And you were interested in it. Lon Milo Duquette was interested in it too at a certain point. And I think perhaps for sort of similar reasons. But in his case, from my understanding of his memoir, he just wanted to see if it was real. That was a strong part of his initial motivation. And that when he was successful, he found himself in a position of not really actually wanting much more beyond that at first. Although I think he did task the demon that he summoned with something to do with a car payment or something like that. I can't remember now exact details. But the initial impulse from my reading of him was really to see if it was real, and hence his rather trivial request was almost an afterthought. I may be a little bit wrong in my memory of his memoir, but that's what I recall. In your case, your interest in the occult was propelled, you told us last time, by something similar, wanting to reach beyond, wanting to contact other aspects of life in some sort of a sense, a curiosity. And so it does seem that Goetia is attractive to people looking for a tangible evidence of the working potential of ritual magic, for example. Do you think that's right? Is that something that's... And so therefore, people are often attracted to it, probably, who are quite early in their magical careers.
Yeah.
Which seems unfortunate.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
What do you think of that? What was it that drew you to the Goetia? And in your colleagues, I know you've had friends who've gone very deep, too deep, actually, into it. What have you noticed is the sort of the life cycle, if you like, of somebody who becomes involved in the Goetia? And do you recognize my... Perhaps slightly misremembered in the case of Milo Duquette. So if that's the case, I apologize to him. Attraction of the Goetia to the beginning magician.
Yeah, no, I do recognize that. And Lon Milo Duquette has some amazing stories in his memoirs. Are really, really good stories. And I think it does fulfill that function. And again, probably because of the nature of the relationship and the nature of the magic, you know, that it entails. I mean, like that example I talked about, I did some magic for some cash, and a wad of material cash drops on the floor in front of me. You know, these are the sorts of effects that you can get from this magic, because it is so material. I remember the very first Goetic ritual I did, the demon manifested as a wailing voice coming through the wall of the room. You know, could hear it. There it was, you know, material, sensory. The last time I did Goetic magic on my own, you know, seriously, was when objects started moving around inside the circle. You know, there was this pen that I had started rolling around the floor, you know, by itself. So I think, yes, you know, this sort of magic, the effects that it can produce are very, very compelling. But they're very material. You know, I mean, I don't want to draw a kind of simplistic contrast between low magic and high magic, but maybe it is useful here. You know, this is low magic. I mean, that, you know, that's another epithet of Lon Milo Duquette. You know, it's low magic. It's very much geared towards the material, the basic. But because of that, it tends to be quite compelling. When I had things rolling around inside the circle, you know, that really scared me, because the circle's supposed to be protective, you know, and that brought home to me that really I didn't have the control that I supposed I had over this sort of working. So you know, that was the last time I did it.
So did you really want cash, or did you want an experience of tangibility in your Goetic working, or was it a bit of both?
Yeah, no, I think it was the latter. I didn't even need cash at the time. The magical group that I was involved in at that time, we were all doing a kind of group thing around wealth magic, and you know, that was my contribution to that. So there wasn't even a real intention there. You know, and I look back on that now, and it's just ridiculous.
What's ridiculous about that?
The fact that there wasn't any real reason to contact that entity. You know, and that in itself sets up a particular dynamic, doesn't it? You know, I'm not serious, and yet there's a sense here of something that is serious, that has something to gain, you know, from me. You know, my lack of seriousness in this context actually makes me vulnerable.
In some systems, I'm thinking not only of Western magic now, but also of certain tantric ritual systems also. There are different criteria for criteria or qualities, you could say, that one has to accrue in order to contact and work with entities of various types. So for in some cases, it's not universal, in some cases a certain degree of purity is required. Moral purity, abstinence, etc. Or maybe there's a degree of sacrifice required. But certainly a degree of offering is quite ubiquitous. Some sort of offering is required. Maybe there's a amount of time or effort or energy and so on. But one of the things also that's sometimes talked about is tup, or magical, spiritual, if you want, potency, sort of power. John Mirren Reynolds, in his interviews with me, he's both a tantric practitioner as well as a Western occultist. He talked quite a bit about that and gave a breakdown, actually, of tantric sadhana through the lens of Western occultism and evocation rituals and so on, and showing parallels and differences and so on. It's quite interesting indeed.
Yeah, wow.
And in the case of the Goetia, what's required for success? It seems a fairly low bar in terms of command of the system itself and the particularly sort of strength of the intention of the magician and et cetera, et cetera. It seems a reasonably low bar. And I know some people experiment with Goetia magic or similar sorts of systems with even a pared down ritual or even pared down ritual implements. Not gathering all the implements needed, but in a way making do with rather pared down kind of setup. And still seem to have some sort of experience, rather. So what do you think about that? Is Goetia a relatively low barrier for entry?
Yeah. Yeah. It's a low bar, perhaps, because all that you need in order to engage with this system of magic is a desire. You know, you need something badly. And that's all that's necessary, I would say, in order for it to have effects. I mean, I had to go through a similar process to what you described other people doing, you know, when I went into Goetia, because, you know, the accoutrements are quite elaborate. You're not going to be able to lay your hands on everything very easily. So I think, you know, people do have to go through a process of deciding what's necessary and what isn't, you know, and I decided that the necessary elements were at the very bare minimum a circle and a triangle, you know, to offer some sort of protection. But I've come across people who dispense even with that. You know, I had a colleague once who would evoke goetic demons with nothing, you know. And I remember him telling a story of doing this one night on a camping trip and people experienced being dragged out of their tent by something invisible in the night, which sounded absolutely terrifying. And yet, you know, he persisted with that system and those methods as well. It is very low bar of entry, I think. But there does seem to be something, even in the Western magical tradition, about having a connection with a higher spiritual entity that will offer protection. So, I mean, in you know, that classic of Western magic, the Abramelin ritual, which is the ritual for contacting the Holy Guardian Angel, the angel is contacted, and then, you know, having gained the authority of the angel, then the demons are summoned and bound. You know, there does seem to be some sort of connection in Western magic with the idea that contact with the Holy Guardian Angel, you know, offers a degree of invulnerability, from demons.
Another system of entity contact, I think the next one that naturally comes to mind, starting with Goetia, as you've done, is the Enochian system. Also rather a controversial system. How would you compare that to the Goetia? And what are your thoughts or comments on that? It's got a very interesting history.
Yeah. And it's not something I've gone into in any great depth. I have scribed the Enochian ethers, and my sense is that the entities that we encounter in this sort of magic maybe take us, up the spectrum of entities a little bit. I mean, I wonder if what we encounter there are things that we might describe more as elemental spirits. And my sense of these, my experience, the type of dynamics that I would apply that word to, elemental, are more to do with spirits that they don't necessarily seek contact with humans at all. Often there's a sense when we run into these beings that they're going about some sort of business, which is quite private or specific to them. And we might be able to glimpse that. We might be able to see them doing that, but they won't necessarily seek any contact with us. When they do, sometimes there's a sense that they might be offering some sort of simple quality or insight. Often they don't seem particularly gifted with knowledge about things, and sometimes they can have a sense about them of being quite sort of time wasting, or but not quite having the maliciousness of demons, perhaps. There's not a sense that they want something or there's something from us that they can have. And I mean, I suppose never really had an experience of what I would call fae, fairies. Never really had I mean, there's a wonderful podcast, the Modern Fairy Sightings podcast, which is brilliant, and people bring their experiences where often they'll encounter beings in nature, that they'll encounter in a perceptual way. I've never really had anything like that, but I think that there is the same flavor of that with the sorts of encounters that I'm talking about, in visions or through meditation. Beings that seem sort of embedded in the nature of reality, that are performing some sort of earthly function, that they go about, without necessarily wanting contact from us. And yet sometimes they can sort of, mess us around, trick us, maybe not even intentionally. That's been my sense of them. The most powerful experience I ever had in this sort of area was on a fire casino retreat a few years ago. And just to say a few words about that, fire casino is a practice that involves very concerted and prolonged concentration upon an object called a kasina. And the kasina can have different material bases to it. It can be a color, or it can be water, or earth, or air. So with fire kasina, generally the object that is concentrated upon is a candle flame. And concentrating upon this for extended periods, leads to some very interested altered states of consciousness, which will probably come back to, because this has also been a means by which I've been able to have experiences of entities higher up the spectrum. But I was doing this particular retreat, I think it was 2017, I was in France, and I ran into quite a lot of difficulty. Intense concentration can really stir up unconscious stuff, and to put it crudely, I really got my ass kicked on this retreat and ran into some really difficult territory. You know, at one point, I remember, you know, really feeling quite distressed and suicidal, and feeling as if my life had collapsed and was worthless, and really I just needed to get it over with, you know, really sort of dark territory. So I kind of had to find a way through this. So I sort of stood back from doing the intense concentration and just went out into the woods for a few days. So I went out into the woods outside the venue, and I was sitting by a stream, you know, among the trees, and it was raining for a lot of the time I was out there. So I would sit out there for hours on end, you know, with a rain mac on, and just concentrate on whatever objects were around me. And what I discovered was, although I wasn't really practicing fire kasina anymore, I was still practicing a form of concentration, meditation, but taking objects, you know, from the natural world, you know, that just happened to be around me. And there's something quite calming in that. And it was useful to do that, considering the place I'd ended up. And what I discovered was, if you do that, so it seems, if you concentrate for an extended period of time upon a particular locality, on a landscape, then you will start to encounter beings, elemental beings, you know, that inhabit that space. It's almost as if, because you penetrate into that landscape with your consciousness, you know, they kind of come into you. And I just remember having these extraordinary visions of these creatures. One I remember was like a kind of insect or mantis that came sort of walking towards me out of the woods. It's iridescent, insect-like creature that was breathing out this kind of blue vapor as it came along. And they were like amalgamations of all the sorts of living things that you would find in that place. So this one was like, you know, something like flies and wasps and centipedes and spiders, you know, all sort of mixed up as if it was some sort of like group entity. And it didn't seem particularly aware of me, didn't seem as if it had anything that it wanted to say to me, but so vivid, you know, and seemed to kind of really embody and encapsulate the spirit of this place. You know, I mean, I think that's the closest I've ever got to a kind of fairy encounter. You know, there were some other beings as well. I remember at one point I could feel vibrations in the earth, you know, when I was sitting there for hours on end. I could feel things moving deep in the earth below me. And then there was a sense of a man made out of rock, a giant, you know, who was trapped in the earth. And I could kind of connect with his sensation of, you know, being trapped underneath the ground and wanting to move and wanting to set himself free, you know. So I don't know, you know, a sense there maybe of some sort of earth energy type being, you know, I don't know.
How did you relate to the experiences? Did you make anything of them, or did you experience them as just simply something had happened and you thought or related to it no further than that? Presumably there was more retreat to come, and did any of these things have any interaction with the terrible time you were having in terms of your own emotional and psychological state?
No, they didn't seem to. You know, they seemed to be absolutely a property of that locality, that landscape, that place. But it was, you know, it was helpful to do that, to take a break from the fire kasina practice and just be in that place, you know, get grounded, you know, feel connection with the earth. Something something that I've noticed on far Kasina practices, you know, not just me, but other people as well, because you're so concentrated on a particular element, you know, far in this case, you start to get a craving for the other elements. So it just felt so wonderful to be out there, you know, on the earth with a stream and wood and wet and damp and fresh air, you know. It sort of provides a counterbalance. And I did manage to get the practice back on track after a few days. But so it was sort of like a bit of a side quest, really, you know, discovering a kind of magic that I'd never really thought about before. Just the idea of going into a landscape and giving it all your attention. And then you will connect with the beings that are there in that landscape.
And in your Fire Kasina retreat, this one in particular, or indeed any of them, did you have a particular objective in mind? I know, having read various accounts of your colleagues, Daniel and others, Shannon, and spoken with some people, there are different objectives for the Fire Kasina retreat. In one case, I think it was Shannon what wished to establish a more vivid contact with her deity, her Buddhist deity, and use the concentration as a sort of way of getting deeper into that sadhana practice and maybe making even some sort of special visionary connection, the like of which you read about all the time, actually, with in the Himalayan stories. And others I know wish to get into high states of concentration brought about by the Fire Kasina, then turn it upon classic insight practices with the hope of becoming enlightened, achieving some sort of level of enlightenment, whatever it may be. And I think others, to return to the Goetia motivation again, I just want to see what will happen and see if they can get something cool, a cool experience of some type. And in your case, what were you seeking in your Fire Kasina practices?
Yeah, so I think for the first Fire Kasina retreat that I did, to have experience of the psychic powers, which it provided. But in that second retreat, which was the one I was just talking about, you know, that was quite difficult, my aim was to have a vision of my holy guardian angel. You know, having seen on the first retreat what was possible, because when we get deeply into that practice, there is the possibility of finding ourselves in different realms of existence, confronted with beings that are sentient and intelligent and respond to us, and it feels as real as it does, you know, talking to you now. In fact, even more real because you're on a screen. I was thinking, well, that'd be cool, you know, if I do that with my holy guardian angel, you know, and he'll be there and I'll see him and he'll be able to tell me all sorts of things. So that was my aim. And unfortunately, I didn't get to that because I ran into the difficulties that I talked about, which really set my concentration practice back. Didn't get into those really concentrated states, didn't have the time because of that setback. But I did have an encounter with my holy guardian angel in the woods, where the sense of the presence of the angel came at a moment when suddenly I heard this huge wind kind of coming through the woods and stirring the tops of the trees. And then, you know, I knew that the angel was there. I felt the presence of the angel. So I did get that intention was realized, but not in a way that I expected it or wanted it to be. You know, I wanted to have this full 3D Technicolor experience. And I think that taught me something, you know, that you don't need that in order to have a connection with, with the Holy Guardian Angel, you know, with higher spiritual beings. It's not necessary. You know, and I was in despair, you know, I felt as if I'd screwed up the retreat, you know, it was all, I'd ruined it, you know, but then to be given that at the end, you know, was just incredible, you know, just felt like a blessing, you know, a beneficence. You know, and again, that's the nature of the relationship that we have with that particular kind of being.
I suppose this fire casino experience, as you're describing, if I'm tracking the years correctly, would be after, or maybe not, after you felt you'd achieved arhatship. Mm. Right. So what is, if you want, the point of all of this after that point?
Yeah. Well, arhatship, you know, as we discussed last time, I'm still not entirely sure about what that is or what that means. You know, I mean, I set out last time what my experience was. You know, there seemed to be four paths, but is that what it is? I don't know. But yes, it was after all that. Something comes into consciousness after an awakening experience, you know, like I talked about last time, something impossible, something that's outside of this world. But although that's amazing to begin with and feels like the answer to everything, all the same issues of attachment and clinging come up again. You know, but in relation now to that, you know, almost as if it's the same old problem, but just at a kind of higher level. You know, so I think there is still, like you were saying, you know, a wanting always something more. You know, a sense that there's always something beyond that horizon that we want. So, like I was saying, you know, what I went into that retreat wanting was a full 3D Technicolor interview with my angel. You know, and then what I realized at the end of it was, didn't really need that. You know, it's not necessary. It's still possible to have that connection with the angel, you know, in all sorts of other ways that's perfectly sufficient in itself.
Okay, very interesting indeed. And for completeness sake, I ought to loop back to your first Kasina retreat. You said you were seeking experience of the psychic powers. Now, of that retreat, Daniel has, on this podcast and other places, he's talked about that retreat in the castle in Scotland. And he talked about drawing sigils in the air. And I don't know whether it was you or Florian, could see the sigil in the air visually that he was drawing. Is that the psychic experience that you were talking about, or were there other psychic experiences or powers that you achieved during that first retreat?
Yeah, no, it was me. I mean, I could see sort of Daniel hovering around, I don't mean literally, outside the castle. And I remember saying to him, did you just draw a orange pentagram in the air? And he was like, yes, I did. Was it a kind of sort of Harry Potter, Doctor Strange experience of seeing light in the air? No, it wasn't. But I knew that that's what he'd done. You know, the thing about the psychic powers, you know, as Daniel himself says in his book, is, you know, they always occur in ways that probably aren't the ways that we think they're going to occur. So I knew what he'd done. And did I see it? I kind of sort of did, but not in a kind of, you know, cinematic sort of way. There were other experiences. I mean, I don't want to say too much about it because it goes into to other people's stuff. But there was one night where I was sitting meditating and I had a sense that something wasn't right. And I had a vision of meeting somebody on the staircase in the castle. And it turned out that what I'd experienced in that moment was something that was happening. That was really quite striking, you know. So there's some sort of telepathy there. I tapped into an experience that someone else was undergoing. So, you know, sort of direct telepathic experience. But the most compelling thing on that first retreat was when I was able to break through into those, you know, the really good stuff. And met this entity, which I describe as the Thai spider Buddha. Very, very strange. What Fire Kasina seems to do is it takes us into a realm of experience that isn't entirely imaginary and yet isn't perceptual either. So the first hint I had of this was a few days in, when I closed my eyes, I would see a kind of vision of a bearded face, you know, like a kind of Zeus type entity, you know, this sort of god figure. But when I moved my head, you know, actually moved my head, the perspective of this image would change. You know, really, really odd. So we've got something there with the qualities of a mental image. I mean, you know, there isn't actually a bearded face in front of me. It's something that's in my imagination. And yet if I move my head, it would shift as if it were perceptual. Very, very strange. This is what the Fire Kasina stuff seems to lead us towards. It's a category of experience that we just have no access to in the everyday world. You know, it requires mega ramped up concentration to get there. So it's something that's not perceptual, but it's not imaginary either. It's something in between. So it must have been about day 12, around that time, I think, when I finally broke into this, you know, the good stuff. I mean, Daniel, you'll have been there for a few days already. Sort of talking about some of the interactions he had had. So yeah, but it was quite unexpected when I had a glimpse of it as well. A lot of the time on a Fire Kasina retreat, what you're working with is third jhana stuff, which is a bit frustrating, a bit sucky. The murk was what we called it. You know, we're concentrating on the visual field, and for days on end, you'll just see sort of like grey static with nothing happening. But if you can stabilise your concentration in fourth jhana, then something shifts, and it's like we break into a completely different space, a completely different world. What happened was I was sitting there concentrating on the visual field. There's this fuzzy grey static, two-dimensional, and something started to happen. And it was like, imagine there's wallpaper on a wall and somebody starts ripping it. It was almost as if the two-dimensionality of what I was confronted with was being ripped away. And in the rips, there was a sense of like a fully three-dimensional space behind. Very, very odd. Very peculiar. There's another world, and it appears by degrees in this state. So suddenly, the two-dimensional visual field was ripped away, and there was a world behind it, and I found myself in this, like, temple somewhere in the east. You know, wooden building, I don't know, sandalwood floors and burning, censers and incense and, wind chimes and all this sort of thing. And it's real. I'm there. I'm in this place. And there's a sense of presence. And suddenly, into this kind of wooden meditation hall, scuttles this really quite alarming looking being, which is the bottom half's a kind of spider, and the top half is a sort of like Thai Buddha, a sort of Buddha figure with one of those sort of tall, pointy hat things, that you see in the iconography of, that sort of flavor of Buddhism. And this being just sort of scuttles up to me as if it's really angry, really pissed off. And all over its legs, these big, thick spider legs, eyes, it's covered in eyes. And all these eyes are sort of like blinking at different rates, and this thing is alive and it knows I'm there and it's sentient. And I was only there for a few seconds, but it's difficult to put into words how extremely real that was. And this had the feeling of some kind of God, despite the sort of strange appearance and the anger of it, it had a aspect to some sort of divine aspect about it. And what I'd say about that, what's the nature of the relationship there? My sense of when we're dealing with divinities is that they embody some sort of quality perfectly. Something is perfectly embodied, and it's so perfectly embodied that it kind of overflows onto us. It's bestowed, it's freely given, it's generously given. And that was the flavor of the relationship with this entity, that it was there to show me something, and it embodied something perfectly. And I was receiving, some sort of quality or transmission from it.
In this case, divine anger.
Some sort of it's difficult to put into words, some sort of rounds. This is real, this is here. Was crazy. I mean, it reminded me of when I was a kid, there always used to be these films on TV by this director called Ray Harryhausen. He used to make these movies with monsters, stop animation monsters. He did films like Jason and the Argonauts and Sinbad, and I mean, they wouldn't show them on TV now because they look so naff, but they look so real and alive, when I was a kid. And it had that sort of feeling about it, except it was as real as real. Some sort of impossible creature, whose nature is completely unfathomable. I mean, what the hell is a spider Buddha? What sort of a thing is that even? But there it was.
Yes, remarkable. Remarkable. But those are great movies too. Jason the Argonaut, I watched that so many times as a kid. That's a fantastic movie.
It is a good one, yeah.
So we're sort of working our way up your spectrum a little bit. We started with the demons, the Goetia, and we could spend hours on each of these levels, of course, but and then we sort of edged into elementals. And your suspicion is that the Enochian system is sort of contacting that. You also talked about land or local sort of land spirits of various types, and now we're edging into deities, and we've also sort of mentioned angels a bit. So we're going up your spectrum that you've prepared. Something about land, local spirits, and so on. From what I understand, one of the very common ways of contacting them or encountering them is through dreams. It seems like the dream is one of the very common ways of when you come to a new place or you're going to a location to do a retreat, for example, and quite quickly a dream will come, etc., etc. So I wonder if you've found that to be the case. Have dreams been a portal for you to meet any entity, I suppose, and particularly local spirits, land spirits, etc.?
Well, I think we need to maybe backtrack a little bit, but it does link nicely with what you've just asked, which is we need to talk about the dead. I think the dead are very important, and certainly with regard to dreams, you know, encountering the dead, I think, has been a very important channel for me in that respect. Not so much with others, you know, with angels, with elementals. It's been mostly through meditation, but certainly with respect to the dead, it's been through dreams, which is, you know, which is perhaps interesting, isn't it? The dead. I mean, I think if we're doing spiritual work, we're all of us called upon at some point, perhaps more than any other type of entity, perhaps to come into some sort of relationship with the dead. You know, it does seem to be very important. And it's something that I struggled with for a long time. There was a time when me and a colleague did a magical working once to contact ancestors, and we were using a spirit box, you know, and we thought, you know, we were just going to summon some ancestors and have a chat with them. And the room filled up with this palpable sense of hatred and hostility, which took us both by surprise. So we tried it again on another occasion and got the same result. And that sent me on some work for, you know, a good number of years to work out what on earth was going on there. And I had to do some serious, serious work to find out what that was about and what it means to have a relationship with the dead. But the earliest experiences I had that showed me something were, you know, around the death of my father, when my dad died. So my dad died in 2011, and he had a massive heart attack that was completely unexpected, collapsed in the street. They weren't able to get an ambulance to him for 45 minutes. So his brain was starved of oxygen. But they did eventually get him started up again. And he was in intensive care. And he sort of hung around for about another 3 days before he died. It was sort of really traumatic at the time, because my parents had moved house not long before, and the only ID my dad had on him was his old address. So he sort of went missing. You know, he didn't come home, and we didn't know where he was. And it was quite some time before we found that he was in the hospital. But we were able to spend time with him for a few days before he passed away, although he was unconscious. So there was a lot there. After my dad died, I was practicing lucid dreaming at the time. I was really, really quite good at it back then. I don't know why, but I seem to have lost the ability now. And what I discovered was I could go and visit my dad in a lucid dream, and there he'd be. And it made me really question, what is it that we experience when we're with a person? You know, when we're with a living person, well, what we experience is certain sights, certain sounds, smells, sensations, And I was having all of those with my dad in the lucid dream. And what I was confronted with was there was no difference in my experience of him in real life when he's alive with this experience of him in the lucid dream and he's dead. So what I was dealing with was I realized that I could get my dad back. You know, there he was back. I could see him, smell him, touch him, talk to him. There he is. But what I started to notice as this went on, because as you might imagine, it got quite addictive. You know, I've lost my dad, I'm grieving, I'm mourning, but I can have him back at night in dreams. But what started to manifest as time went on was if I did anything that demanded from him any sort of response, something unpleasant would start to happen. So if I asked him a question, you know, and it was something, you know, like, where are you now? Or, you know, something about the future, perhaps, you know, what are you going to do? Or something like that. Unpleasant things would start to happen. Like he'd start to make strange noises, or his face would contort, or he'd start behaving in strange ways that weren't like him. And over time, I started to realize that, well, he can't respond to anything. You know, he's dead, he's gone. And it struck me that, you know, this was showing me something about the nature of the dead. Kind of like shells, you know. I could get him back, but that was what he was. That was how he was, you know, and being dead means that there isn't anything in the future. There isn't anything beyond that. And I remember what, when it finally came to a resolution was, I was with my dad and I was talking to him and explaining to him, you know, how we missed him. And then suddenly we were in a garden. I was standing with my mother and he'd gone. He'd just disappeared. And both of us were just kind of looking up at the stars. And there was a sense that, you know, that's what he was, where he was now. You know, that just that image of the stars. You know, what that really brought home to me is something about the nature of the dead, you know, of what we encounter when we encounter the dead, which is, it's like, you know, a collection of karma. It's like the stuff that they were and the stuff that they've left behind. Yeah. The dead, they leave behind things. They leave behind questions, sometimes demands. You know, there may be things that they wanted of us. And those are the important things in the relationship that we have, you know, with the dead after somebody's died. And if we pay attention to those, that can help us live more fully. You know, thinking about what my dad, you know, might have wanted for me, you know, what was left over from our relationship, you know, the conflicts, the questions, the, you know, the debates that went on between us. You know, it's the engagement with that that's the important aspect of the relationship. I mean, you know, to contrast them with demons, you know, demons make demands on us. Demons want stuff. But that's in order to take stuff away from us. You know, it's not what's going on with the dead. You know, if we pay attention to what the dead are demanding from us, you know, there's actually potential there for us to grow, for us to live more fully. You know, it might mean ignoring what they wanted. You know, it might mean recognizing that you know, the demands they put on us, you know, weren't right for us in the first place. Yeah, I think the nature of the relationship between the living and the dead is like that process with my dad, what I went through there, getting to that place where I could let him go, you know, and he could become part of the stars. I think what we do as the living is we help the dead to die. You know, we help them to relinquish their hold on life and move on to whatever's next. And then, like I was saying, I think their role for us is to help us live more, you know, to you know, if we enter into a constructive relationship to the dead, they can set us free from the past. And I think there's something peculiar going on in our culture at the moment that seems to be about some sort of upset in the relationship between the living and the dead. When I talk about that working that we did, that anger that I experienced with my colleague, that seemed to be what that was about. I mean, strange thing these days is we tend to judge the dead by the standards of the present. You know, you notice that happening a lot. You know, like cancelling the dead. You know, people. You know, the dead will get cancelled because of, you know, attitudes and beliefs that they had. But they're not accountable to us. They're dead. And by doing that, we're keeping them alive. You know, by holding them to the standards of the present, that's assuming that they should be in relationship with that. You know, which of course they can't be. It's almost like we're kind of, by judging them, you know, we're kind of keeping them alive, kind of hauling them into the present. You know, very strange. And we want them to be like us. It's almost like we're demanding that the dead should be more like us, which is really, really messed up when you think about it. I think, you know, some of the cultural conflicts that we're going through at the moment, you know, we could phrase them perhaps in you know, in terms of the relationship with the dead. You know, it's sort of a bit out of kilter for some reason at the moment. If we can help them to die more, they can help us to live more. I mean, that's my sense.
It's a very interesting perspective on the current cultural moment or aspects of it. That's a very interesting perspective.
I mean, something you'll find a lot in Jung. You know, Jung is talking about this a lot. The dead came back from Jerusalem, where they found not what they sought. You know, the angry dead that invade his house. And he has to teach them.
Yeah. That's a terrifying idea of holding the dead to our standards and demanding they be like us. I think that betrays, if we take your reading, betrays a remarkable lack of self-reflection.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I'd want to reduce the dead, the past, the people of the past, to whatever moral level I might possess. Very pinched moral perspective, I think, that seeks to do that.
Yeah. And I think it's, you know, maybe what's there as well is a fear of death.
Of course.
Yeah. It's holding, you know, it's almost as if there's only this side of things, you know, and everybody's got to be on this side, the dead too, you know, they've got to live up to the present as well, but they don't have to, you know, they're not accountable to us, but we are to them.
I'm curious about that second point, but also, of course, other than a denial of death, it's a denial of one's own, an anxiety perhaps about one's own moral imperfection and evolution. If I look back over my own life, only because it's, I think, most polite to cast moral judgments upon oneself rather than others, I can certainly see change. I can, I've changed my opinions about things. I've changed my orientations about things. In some areas, I've become a better person. Not in every area, but in some areas, I've become a better person. The old version of me, who's now dead, I presume, I can't go back and be whatever in my younger years. You have to leave that be, in a sense. There's not much you can do about the past, except you can't hold the past accountable, in other words, in that sense. So one has to allow oneself possibility of improvement. And if you deny the dead, if you deny the hi history, its own context, then in a sense, I wonder if it's a sort of displacement, in a sense, of one's own possibility of improvement and so on.
I mean, that's a really good point, I think, and a really good way of approaching it. And like you're saying, we have past versions of ourselves, don't we? And the same, the same conditions apply there. I mean, one thing in therapy that you often see is people giving themselves such a hard time for who they used to be, for what they used to do. So much regret and angst over, old ways of being and thinking, rather than seeing those as, the essential stepping stones that were absolutely required to get to where they are now, the better place. It's also helpful to think about this in relation to that other point that I brought up about us being accountable to the dead. I mean, our former selves, we want to do the best for them, don't we?
Can you say more about that?
Oh,
This accountability to the dead and our former selves.
I mean, those former selves, that the present self feels so much shame and angst about. We want to be the best we can be for them. So they don't have to hold that shame and that angst. And I think likewise with the living and the dead, we want to carry on, what the dead laid down, do better, be better than them, with not punishing them, which I think is often the attitude that's there these days, but just to be better for them. Whatever form that takes, I mean, that can take all sorts of different forms, of course. It's odd. It seems important. It seems like the relationship with the dead, is something that everybody on a spiritual path gets called upon to work out. That's my sense. And Jung, Jung is really, really strong on this. It took me a long time to really start to understand what Jung was getting at with this. I mean, one of the things he talks about, which I think is important, he talks about you have to recognize you're dead. It's not just the dead in general, that we're working with, but our own dead, the people who have left us with questions and demands. Who are they? I mean, of course, there's going to be people that we know, who have passed away and left questions in our lives, but sometimes there are figures, cultural figures perhaps, or ancestral figures who, you know, karmically have something important to share with us. Sometimes you'll run across these in meditation as well. I mean, I've had this where I've had kind of ancestral figures appear, you know, who aren't specific people, who aren't people I knew, you know, but people from the past who seem to present something. Like, you know, just to share a personal example, I mean, the poet John Clare, for me, seems to be like one of these important ancestral figures. You know, he's somebody who comes from the same part of the world that I grew up in, who, you know, he was writing around the time of the Romantics, but unlike most of the Romantics, he was an agricultural labourer. You know, he's working in the fields and he writes these amazing poems about nature, you know, the stuff that he knows. And he was sort of adopted as a bit of a cultural curiosity, you know, taken to London, you know, introduced to figures on the literary scene and floundered, you know, and eventually ended up, you know, with severe mental difficulties, you know, committed to an asylum. Alan Moore writes a lot about John Clare. You know, so sometimes figures like that really, really speak to us down the years. And yeah, and I've had figures emerge as well through meditation, like I said, like this character Badger suddenly appeared one day, coming out of the fields, singing a song, who told me that he came from 1650 and he got a bag on his back that was full of radical pamphlets. He was not on the side of Cromwell, but certainly not a royalist either, but something more radical than Beau. There's this idea that I've come across, I can't remember the name of the writer now, but he talks about the dead who are well in spirit, you know, the perfected dead. I'm not sure if that's quite the term that he uses, but these are figures that can appear. You know, they come from just before or beyond our remembered ancestors, you know, the ancestors that we know the names of. And they represent a kind of, you know, collective sort of ancestral energy. You know, and this Badger figure, I think, was one of those for me. Curiously, he told me that he came from 1650, and subsequently I did some family research, and the furthest I could trace back my family line was, you know, just after 1650. It was almost as if, you know, he'd predicted that, you know, that's the time when, you know, the names of my ancestors that I know, you know, run out.
And in both of those cases, in what way do you feel accountable to them? Or what are the implications of those strong contacts for you?
Difficult to put into words. I think, you know, Badger represents sort of ideas politically, morally, you know, that have some sort of impact for me. You know, the figure of John Clare, you know, speaks a lot to me about the sort of stuff that I've ended up doing with my life and the fact that I've been able to do it. You know, questions and demands, they present us with questions and demands. And if we think about them, they can help us to live more fully, to realise our potential more fully, I think. I think the work with the dead is really important. You know, never mind about getting enlightened or, you know, having psychic powers and stuff. You know, I think it's the meat of of the work, I think, you know. Thinking about the dead even if it's just, you know, recently deceased people in our family line.
What's funny?
You're such an enigma, Steve. I can see I can see all sorts going on.
Oh, really? Like what?
Yeah.
You can see all sorts going on, like what?
Yeah. Well, hoping that you know, this is useful. This is useful to people, because it's certainly been useful for me. You know, I've really felt helped by the dead recently. There's, you know, the mainstream idea is that when someone's dead, that's it, they're gone. You know, they drop out of existence and nothing remains. But we live in the world of the dead. You know, you look around and everything's been put here by the dead. You know, it's really, really, we live in the world of the dead. It's their place rather than ours. You know, I think there's a lot to be gained from engaging with that.
Yeah, that's very interesting indeed. What would you recommend as a beginning to, I suppose, explore what the themes you're bringing up now? So we started off with entities of various types, and now we're moving very strongly into this theme of the dead, and seems a very powerful theme indeed. How would you recommend? Would you recommend?
Yeah, again, I'm not sure. Not sure I could or should. You know, because it of course, you know, it's going to bring things up. It's going to bring things up. I mean, thinking about, you know, what happened with me. I mean, I was compelled into this, you know, by bereavement, losing my father. That was what triggered it. And then I did that working, and, you know, we got that angry, cold response from the dead, you know, and that, you know, I had to work that out. I felt compelled to work that out. So I suppose, you know, what I'm saying there is, you know, be attentive, you know, to the dead.
You know, as you're talking about this, you're reminding me of accounts of the dead in great literature. For example, the Odyssey, or perhaps the Aeneid, rather related works. In the Odyssey, of course, Odysseus goes to the underworld to find the blind seer, Tiresias, and he is trying to figure out why it is he keeps getting thwarted going home, and he has to go to find the seer and get some information. So he goes to the dead for that reason. But along the way, and in order to access the dead, he has to go to a special place and do blood magic, actually.
Yeah.
And the dead sort of swarm him in a way. And he meets all kind of people and discourses with them, including Achilles. The Odyssey, of course, happening in the aftermath of the Trojan War, where Achilles featured very heavily indeed and was killed there. And he meets him as a shade, and he finds out that Achilles actually regrets his life of glory and heroism. And he says, I would give up my great glory and legacy just to be a slave of someone in the living world. You know, he regrets, in other words, his orientation towards glory, live fast, die young, which was Achilles' choice. And of course, Odysseus also meets his mother there, who he didn't know was dead.
Yeah.
And he asks her how she died. And she tells him that she died from a broken heart at Odysseus being gone for so long. 10 years in Troy, in the war there. It took him 10 years to get home too. In that period of time, his mother had died of a broken heart, of his absence. And he's very grief-stricken by this, and he tries to embrace her. Once, twice, thrice. Of course, you can't embrace the dead. Evidently, in your dream you could, but Odysseus couldn't in the underworld anyway. She was incorporeal, as you pointed out.
Yeah.
And the same in the Aeneid. On this occasion, Aeneas, with the priestess Sibyl, goes into the underworld, and here he's seeking his father, Anchises. He's seeking him, and this is a more elaborate death scene, underworld scene, crossing the river, drugging Cerberus, the three-headed dog, with some, you know, some like herb-infused meat and stuff like that. But as they go through the underworld seeking Anchises, they pass all various different places in the underworld, and Aeneas is shocked by this, these places, and he asks the priestess, wow, what's this place, and how do you end up here, and what's this place, and how do you end up here? And he also meets all kind of people and encounters them down there, including his old comrade, Palinurus, the navigator, who is dead, and he didn't realize, anyway, I digress. And eventually he finds his father, and his father is in the sort of paradise part of the afterworld, of the afterlife of the underworld, the paradise place. And he's there and he meets him, and the both of them are so excited to see each other, and it's a very warming meeting between father and son. And his father gives him various advice. But then Aeneas looks and he sees a whole gathering, a host of shades gathering at a body of water. And it's the water of Lethe, which you drink to forget. And he says, what's going on here? And his father explains to him how reincarnation works from their point of view. And he says, well, when you've been down here, you've been dead for a while, you burn off whatever, you're purified, basically. However, depending on how you come in, you have a certain amount of that to be done. And then you can be, when you've done that, you're ready to be reborn again. And so you, when you're ready for that, you come to this place and you drink from the water of forgetting. And that's how you sort of get the tabula rasa, and then off you go to your reincarnation. And then it turns out that this host is Aeneas's descendants. Wow. The host, yeah, he sees his descendants. After the fall of Troy, Aeneas, who's on the Trojan side, he flees that place as it falls, you know, after the Trojan horse comes in, all that stuff, and it's all burning, and he runs away, and he takes some refugees with him, and they flee. And he's seeking the site to found Rome, and he has these visions and dreams that he's going to do that. And so, but he's losing his way a bit. He's having a lot of difficulties, and so he's drawn into the underworld to seek his father, and his father says, these are your descendants. This is the future of Rome. And he meets, you know, he points out various different great figures of Roman history that are going to follow him. And he's so shocked by this, he gets, in other words, a vision. His father gives him a vision of Rome, a vision of his future, a vision of what comes after him. You know, when you're by yourself, when you're a human being, you know, in the present, it's very difficult to see the vast ripples and implications of what comes after you and what might come through you. And so, armed with that vision, he exits the underworld and galvanized and goes on, you know. And so, just reminded of those two accounts, it seems necessary in both cases that they go back, they go to the underworld, and for somewhat different reasons, somewhat similar reasons.
I think the Greek, the Roman, the idea of the shades in the underworld, you know, really resonates with the sense I had of the dead as shells, you know, as bundles of karma. You know, sort of real, but not real, has a certain solidity, you know, as long as it stays in the past. I mean, with my dad sometimes, you know, those experiences I talked about in lucid dreams, you know, sometimes I just sit there, you know, and not engage him or do anything because I knew that he wouldn't be able to respond, you know, and that would make him seem, you know, most solid, most real, you know, when he was just there being what he was. you know, as soon as there was any moving away from that, then weird, strange, horrible things would happen. Yeah, you can't have an epic, can you, without a descent into the underworld?
And the interesting thing about the Aeneid is that the dead give the vision for the future. That that's what made me think of it, is your idea of this you've expressed of an accountability to the dead somehow. And them helping us live more fully. You've said those two things.
But I don't think we get the, you know, the very clear presentation of that that Aeneas gets, you know, and of course, you know, Virgil's writing sort of propaganda, isn't he, in a way? So he's presenting a certain, you know, a certain type of future. But I think very much, you know, like you were pointing out, there's a sense that we owe it to the dead to live fully.
I always think it's a shame when people say, of course, Virgil was writing propaganda. I think it's always a shame. I think that's, what did I say before? Rather pinched lens. Of course, it's true. You know, it's true. It was a founding myth and had its, you know, socio-political motivations. So did the great fifth Dalai Lama, who was a very important figure in Tibetan history, for example, with his Senge Gyatso, his minister. They wrote voluminously and did a lot to create a kind of mythos or a main plot for Tibet, gathering threads from the imperial period, gathering ideas from the Avalokiteshvara cult, popularized by many people, including, you know, Tisha, for example, the 11th century, and sort of bringing all that together and saying the Dalai Lamas are the incarnation of Avalokiteshvara, who has a special interest in Tibet and has always worked for its benefit back to the time of the imperial Dharma kings, Sonsen Gyatso, etc. And they were emanations of Avalokiteshvara. And now there's a continuation of that in the Dalai Lama line. They're the emanations of that, and that sort of chosen people kind of narrative or special Buddha field narrative. I'm very interested in that, actually, the way in which story, myth, and history are used. And it sort of a little bit relates, I think. It's not unrelated to what you're talking about, the dead's relevance to the living, and the way in which history, story, and myth can be used to create a sense of national identity. Or personal, I suppose, mission perhaps.
Is not the fundamental question there, perhaps, what are we going to carry forwards? You know, just thinking of all those different instances that you've presented there, you know, and you know, maybe it's about constructing some sort of national myth. But even so, underneath that is this question, you know, what are we going to take forwards from what went before? You know, and I think we all confront that question. And I'm not sure, like I was saying, you know, culturally in this moment, I'm not sure that question's being asked so much, perhaps. You know, it's sort of expecting the dead to be like us. You know, almost sort of turning around to the dead and saying, you know, come on, you should be better. Which is very strange.
Indeed. Well, this has been very fascinating. We might have to make this a triptych, you know,
Oh my God.
some point. Once you've recovered, of course, from our descent into the underworld. Yeah, very interesting. The last point, and perhaps this is a bit of a curveball, but while we're on the subject of entities. You know, one of the great themes of occult fiction I'm thinking of things like James Blish's Black Easter and, you know, that sort of... Do you know that one, James Blish's Black Easter?
No, I've not come across this one.
Oh, okay. Well, James Blish wrote this two-part... the first one is called Black Easter, and it's about a ritual magician who brings about the apocalypse by opening up the Goetia such that all of the Goetian demons emerge. And so the first book is a lot about, and he's hired to do, goes into lots and lots of detail about ritual workings and summoning and that sort of stuff. And then all, lots of demons come out. And it's, I think, known as one of the very accurate depictions of ritual high magic.
So yeah, it sounds good.
It's not a very long book. It's but anyway, so one of the themes is that if it's the case that one can contact demons and elementals and angels and divinities, etc., and your average aspiring magician, you know, in a bedsit in Lewisham or whatever, where I used to live, I'm thinking of my old place, can do it. So presumably other kinds of people could do it. Are these forces harnessed or used or recruited in some way, not just by people seeking cool experiences or seeking to reconcile their inner conflicts or pay off their car loans and stuff, but who want to rule the world or at least gain power on a, should we say, slightly more ambitious scale than we've been discussing? What do you think of that? Is it the case, in your opinion, that these sorts of workings can be used on a more ambitious scale? Politics, celebrity, etc. Or is it only people in bedsits in Lewisham who need to pay off their car payment who are using these high esoteric technologies?
I don't know. I'm thinking of, again, that Goetic magic incident that I talked about. You know, the cash falls out the guy's pocket. So in order to have the cash that I'd asked for, I would have to steal to get it. Maybe there are only certain ways of getting power. Maybe in order to be a celebrity or, you know, be a top politician, you have to do that in a certain way. You have to be a certain sort of person. You have to employ certain sorts of methods. So, and maybe, you know, those methods aren't commensurate with magic. That's what I'm wondering.
Are not commensurate.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, do I see Keir Starmer on a fire casino retreat? Do I see, you know, Liz Truss on a Vipassana, you know, retreat? But I think in order to get to where they are, maybe you do have to be a Liz Truss or a Keir Starmer. There is this idea, isn't there, that, you know, there is some sort of grand conspiracy, that it's all a secret cabal of wizards sort of running the show.
Right.
Yeah, but I don't know if that's what wizards do. I don't know if you could do that and still think of yourself as a wizard or be a wizard.
Yes, it's striking to me. I like to ask magicians that sort of a question because it's in a way taking the premise and extending it logically with a little bit more ambition. And historically speaking, it's certainly been the case that magic and power have gone together. Now, of course, those were times when magic was seen in a different light to it is today, older times. And I mean, to bring Tibet up once again, lots of working with protectors and rituals and things of that nature and sorcery of various types. It was hand in glove with power and military action and other things like that. It was just taken to be fairly obvious. It wasn't particularly a strange thing. And I think even in this country, there were times when that perhaps that was at least gestured towards. Maybe those were more superstitious times. You know, who knows? But it always strikes me as a little interesting that magicians are willing to summon demons to pay off their car loans and don't, but have us, and we look at history and we see court magicians to people of power and so on, then there's this sort of interesting gap. Maybe magic is a merely trivial pursuit and limited to that rather mundane range of wanting experiences and floating sigils and paying off car payments and so on. Maybe it's not applicable to anything beyond that. It seems a little bit of a skip in the record, though.
Yeah, but it's odd, isn't it? Like, where, as a magician, would you align yourself politically? You know, because the thing that strikes me about, you know, the current situation and debates in the magical community at the moment, you know, a lot of it seems very much along, you know, the usual cultural lines, left-wing magicians versus right-wing magicians.
Right.
But they're all magicians. You know, what is it? What is it that makes someone a magician? You know, it's obviously not politics. I mean, you know, you can have Julius Evola, you know, who was, you know, explicitly a fascist. But you can also have, you know, people on the left doing magic as well. And yet they're both magicians. You know, so, I mean, the problem I have is what makes someone a magician isn't anything in this world. You know, that's not the commonality. It's something beyond that. I mean, I can, you know, read Julius Evola and see, you know, that he was oriented towards, you know, the same things. I mean, he's written books on yoga, he's written books on Buddhism. You know, they have a very skewed slant to them. but he's engaging with that. You know, he knows what awakening is. He knows what emptiness is. You know, that's the trouble I have with it. I mean, I was having a... It's interesting you should bring this up, because I was having a strange thought the other day, but, you know, thinking about, you know, what is the experience of the dead? What is it like? You know, and I was thinking about how, you know, it will probably be quite nice to be free from politics once you're dead. Because, of course, you know, politics is all about the future, you know, what should happen, what must happen. And, you know, my sense has been there isn't any more of that for the dead. You know, it's like Achilles, as he was saying, you know, for him it was all about glory and honour, you know, and then suddenly it's not anymore.
Chaos. In this case, yeah.
Right. What's the translation?
Oh, it's just as you say, really.
Right. Yeah.
Glory, honour. Are you implying that a magician's work will take him beyond the concerns of temporal power and politics, that that will be something that a magician sees through? Or are you suggesting that magicians, just like accountants, can be of any political persuasion?
I think perhaps the former. I find it difficult to see how, from a magical perspective, there would be a sense of, you know, an entrenched political position. You know, other than it being a means to an end. You know, everything in the everyday world is fallen, you know, is corrupt. It's a falling away from the absolute, you know, is my sense. So, I mean, you know, I think the reason, you know, socialism fails, for instance, is because people don't actually like to be equal to everybody else. And I think the reason why capitalism fails, you know, as is becoming ever more clear at this time in history, is because, you know, capitalists don't like competition. It's bad for business. You know, I mean, I would identify as a socialist. I think clearly it's the case that what is needed in the current historical moment is, you know, socialist policies to restore, you know, some greater degree of equality, because that seems to be, as far as I can see, the problem at the moment in Western countries. But there's too much inequality. Clearly that's what needs to happen. Clearly it's not going to happen. If I'd been born at a different historical moment, would I have thought differently? You know, maybe. You know, maybe it would depend on what needed to be done. So, you know, my feeling is that if you wanted temporal power, you would need to enter into the mechanisms of it. You know, you would need to identify really closely with those. And I think that would take you away from a magical perspective. You know, at the end of the day, politics being a sort of earthly temporal thing can only be a means to an end.
Even though in the Goetia, certain of the list promise temporal power various times.
Well, of course they would.
So there must be room in the magical perspective for that, is what I'm. Is why I brought that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, as we were saying, that sort of magic demands entering into a certain sort of dynamic.
So does politics.
Yeah, but it's a dynamic. You know, where, well, what is the end point? When do we have enough power? I mean, I'm always amazed with you know, the billionaires that we encounter these days, you know, when they've got more money than they could possibly spend in a lifetime, you know. And yet, evidently, it's not enough. They want more. Might be nice to be free of that wanting more, perhaps.
I think that might be a good point to end it. What do you think?
Nice.
Just gesturing to ultimate freedom.
Yeah.
Well, this has been so fascinating. Duncan Barford, thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. Pleasure as always.
Thank you for listening to another Guru Viking podcast. For more interviews like these, as well as articles, videos, and guided meditations, visit www.guruviking.com.